Thinking about space exploration can sometimes seem disheartening in that everything is so far away. While we can visit any place in the solar system, we've only ever set foot on the moon, and while Mars is within our grasp, humans have not yet been there in person. Any further is currently only a dream, but to actually head out into the galaxy and explore other star systems is at least a long way off, and it's possible we may never do it at all, or only limitedly so. At this point in time, interstellar distances just seem too daunting, and as a result, it will be a long time before we see an exoplanet close up, and maybe never in person. But the ability to study other star systems does extend beyond just watching from afar. It had always been suspected that at least two objects in the solar system were formerly interstellar comets that were captured by Jupiter because of the odd characteristics of their orbits. And just a few years ago, what was the first confirmed interstellar object, Oumuamua, was observed passing through, followed not long after by the second such object, Comet Borisov. This now gives us the opportunity to study material from other star systems from the comfort of home. But it's not just limited to objects in space, but rather it has recently been shown and confirmed that interstellar meteors can be detected entering Earth's atmosphere and determined to be of interstellar origin by the speeds at which they enter and the angles. This opens up the possibility of interstellar meteorites actually making it to Earth's surface, and through the study of isotope ratios in our collections and new finds, we may someday identify an object sitting here on Earth that could have an origin halfway across the galaxy for all we know. And we may just have such an object already. Studying data from JPL's Center for Near-Earth Object Studies, Amir, Siraj, and Avi Loeb found a candidate for an interstellar meteorite entering the Earth's atmosphere in 2014, link in the description below. This quickly became a contested claim, in that first, the paper couldn't be published in the journals because the error bars of the spy satellite that captured the meteorite's fall were classified. And of course, the debate over whether the speed of an object entering the atmosphere is necessarily due to an interstellar hyperbolic origin. More recently, however, the US Space Command came out in favor of the interstellar origin. This is based on the direction and speed at which the meteorite entered the atmosphere, which was 45 kilometers a second, leaving little room for it to not have been of interstellar origin. So if that's the case, then the story gets even more interesting. Estimates on the size of the object before it entered is on the order of half a ton or a meter in diameter, and that's large enough for significant fragments to have reached the surface of the Earth. The fall happened over or near Papua New Guinea. Based on the trajectory, fragments would have landed in the ocean in a relatively small area, opening up the possibility for a search of the seafloor to recover material from the object for analysis. That's right. There could very well be material from another star system sitting on the ocean floor near Manus Island off the coast of Papua New Guinea. This also unseats Oumuamua as the first interstellar object ever detected. Unfortunately, as to its actual origins, interstellar is probably going to be all we can say. The exact origins of interstellar objects can only be traced back so far, sort of like trying to reconstruct a game of billiards by the position of the balls. There's only so much you can do, but you can know that the object was not from here. But what can be said is that the object's velocity was high relative to average speeds of stars in our region of the galaxy. This opens up the possibility that this could be some very interesting material indeed. That would tend to suggest that whatever this material is from, it originated close into its star, as opposed to being material from the Oort cloud equivalent of another star system, where you would expect such ejected material to be from. That means it could be from a planet or asteroid belt, perhaps similar to the material from our asteroid belt or even Earth or Mars. It's probably a good idea to go look for material from this meteorite, but as far as interstellar material in general, we have some such objects already, though they are very tiny and themselves originate in meteorites. There is a class of very primitive meteorite linked to comets that are known as carbonaceous chondrites, and within them are structures known as chondrules that represent pebbles essentially from the original solar nebula. Contained within these structures, there have been identified dust grains that predate the solar system and are of interstellar origin. And it's worth noting that our ability to search for interstellar meteorites on Earth is actually increasing. Meteorites fall to Earth randomly, most of them fall into the ocean, but the distribution of meteorites is more or less even. But the kind of terrain where they fall varies, and some places on Earth are better for hunting for meteorites than others. Two such places are the Sahara Desert and Antarctica. In the sandy Sahara, there isn't much rock, so when you come across a rock, there's a very good chance of it being of meteoritic origin. Antarctica itself isn't so great, due to things getting buried in the ice during snowstorms, but glaciers move and melt, and as a result, the Antarctic ice sheet in places functions as a kind of conveyor belt. So any meteorites that are contained in the ice get conveniently deposited in the melt zones of the glaciers, in areas such as the Ellen Hills. All that's needed is for scientists to literally go and pick them up. But interstellar dust isn't the only thing found in the carbonaceous meteorites. There have also been interstellar diamonds found in one particular meteorite, and several show anomalous carbon isotopes that are of interstellar origin as well. And one thing these meteorites show is that carbon and its chemistry is very widespread and common in the universe. The building blocks of life are everywhere. But anomalous meteorites are nothing new. One example is a meteorite found a few years ago that shows an isotope composition remarkably similar to the Earth and the Moon, but just slightly off enough to raise questions. It's thought that this meteorite actually originated on Theia, getting blasted off before Earth collided with it, only to wander space for billions of years and still manage to collide with Earth, meaning that in some way, the collision of Earth and Theia that formed the Moon is still ongoing. But as Oumuamua showed, we may not be expecting the reality and diversity of interstellar materials that could come our way. And the study of these objects may have implications that may be far more profound than simple geologic oddities. We know from meteorites of volcanic origin that planets such as Mars and indeed even Earth can have rocks ejected from them and fall on another body. And herein is a rather strange story. We actually have found an Earth rock in space. And, in fact, it's very likely the oldest Earth rock we have, coming in at over 4 billion years old. In the Apollo 14 samples collected in 1971, a rock was discovered with a very out-of-place clast. This 2-gram clast is composed of quartz, zircon, and feldspar. These are rare rocks on the Moon, but very common on Earth. Evidence was also found that the material formed in an oxidized environment, and at temperatures consistent with a shallow origin in Earth's crust, making Earth the most likely origin point for it. The age of the rock is interesting because it's from about the same time on Earth when life was arising here. But the material was not pristine, itself having partially melted in at least 2 lunar impacts. At some point after it was deposited, one ancient and one as recent as 26 million years ago that formed Cone Crater, which is where the Apollo mission explored. That we found such material in the handful of missions we've sent to the Moon to get samples suggests that Earth material is probably relatively common on the Moon, and more pristine material could someday be found as we study the lunar surface more in depth. And there is the possibility that even sedimentary rock from early Earth might have been blown off at some point, and even fossils that may shed light on the earliest days of life on this world. It's a long shot, but it's possible we may learn more about Earth and the genesis of life here from materials preserved in space than we will from the weathering and constantly renewing surface of the Earth. And this brings up another possibility. What of fossils from other worlds? This has already happened, but apparently in terms of a false alarm. Structures found in the Martian meteorites for years looked very lifelike, with the possibility that they were fossilized remains of bacteria. This was called into question, however, and work done since suggests that they are not the remains of life, but the product of geologic processes, though in fairness, this subject is still a matter of debate. But what wasn't questioned was the idea of it being possible for a fossil from Mars to end up on Earth. And if that's the case, then is it possible for a fossil contained in an interstellar object to be found? Yes, but it's complicated by the fact that whatever impact caused the ejection of the interstellar object from its parent system had to do it at sufficient energy for it to get ejected from the system. It's possible, but limiting. So there may be no fossils from Earth traveling the interstellar medium, but there could be situations where sedimentary rocks originating from exoplanets might get blasted off and leave their system, paving the way for a rather odd new field of science, astropaleontology. And there may be another. If an inhabited exoplanet were to be hit by another planetoid or any sufficiently energetic impact or other means of ejection at interstellar trajectories, even technology or some trace of a technosignature, or even a fragment of concrete, could get ejected and sent into the interstellar medium, which would then pave the way again for astroarchaeology, above and beyond studying intentionally sent probes or defunct alien space technology that may be passing through, as is on the table for Oumuamua if it is indeed artificial in nature. But that brings up another possibility. Rock is very long-lived, and in space it can last many billions of years undisturbed. That may make it a very good form of METI. In other words, you could shoot out fossil-bearing rock samples out of your star system in hopes of someone out there finding the samples and learning that there is life elsewhere in the universe. This would be an unbelievably lucky chance find. The chances are almost zero, but you could increase them by encasing the materials in a beacon that emits a radio signal when in proximity of a star, or other such technosignature that can be detected, like artificial lighting. This is all a long shot, but there is one definite area where interstellar objects will be enlightening. That's geology. Geologic processes are different depending on the object of origin. For example, you won't find certain types of rock that occur here on Earth in the asteroid belt, because the conditions of the formation of rocks is different. Most interstellar objects we see are expected to be comets, nudged out from the Oort clouds of star systems, but asteroids and fragments of planets can also be reasonably expected. That means different geology and different types of objects, so if we do find materials from exoplanets, they may shed light on what the planet of origin was like, and even if it had liquid water or oxygen at any point in its history. But there are other possibilities that may or may not be viable, such as hydrogen icebergs from star-forming regions, materials from a kilonova, and even metallic hydrogen, which is thought to be metastable, or exotic forms of matter hypothesized to exist, but we've never seen or synthesized. So while we may or may not ever travel interstellar distances to explore exoplanets, we can at least study materials from them. And with the advent of the Vera Rubin Survey Telescope, we will be set to regularly discover and eventually visit and study any number of interstellar objects, and they will no doubt be full of surprises. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently concerned about an alien finding a dinosaur bone, or a frozen dinosaur, blasted off the surface of Earth millions of years ago. They might be surprised and find that it's some kind of analog of themselves and start searching for the dinosaur world, only to find us and the birds. Think cranky, disappointed velociraptor aliens knocking on the door. Not good. And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.